Good morning, guys. So let's start with the new discussion altogether, not on direct taxes, on indirect taxes, right? So direct taxes, somehow many people here are having enough idea. I can presume that, right? Sufficient idea about direct taxes, even new batch, old batch, both. Old batch, see, new batch I am 100% sure because we are in touch. What about old batch? Old batch should say, yes sir, we know everything about direct taxes. Okay, and if you, even if you forgot, if you have forgotten, it's okay. Matlab basic to pata hoga, right? So those basics we will challenge here. Secondly, if you know service tax and VAT, it was there in our syllabus, right? In service tax, we had invested more than enough time and we had bahated many provisions of service tax, right? From a definition onward, section 66 B, section 65 B, clause 44, definition of service, inclusive, exclusive part, right? There was a 3-page definition of service that we bahated in classroom itself, right? Everything is gone. So do not remember anything from service tax. Do not follow any principle fundamental of service tax in now indirect tax. Okay, current indirect tax is completely new, 100% brand new. Although it has taken some advantage, some basis which were there in service tax, because service tax was a recently introduced law. See, excise is an old law, right? VAT was old law, CST was old law, but service tax was recently introduced law. So recent means how recent? Service tax was introduced in 1996. But in 2012, you know that service tax was completely changed, right? And every year they were changing service tax. That means whatever service tax you people have studied last time, exactly similar provision you may find in my GST. So that part will be common part. Last service tax, latest service tax, if you have studied service tax in 2016, I must say, right? 30% of sections and provisions like point of taxation rules, right? Place of provision of service rules, reverse charge mechanism. You understand all these words? Yeah, that part is common in my GST. So that much work will be done automatically. Now you people know it, but those people don't know it. Right, and that's why merging of this batch will be for 3 days. After 3 days, we will split the batch. Okay, new batch we will do it later because your syllabus is still not notified. Okay, old batch syllabus is notified, but whatever syllabus has been notified, that was on 1st July. Law that they pass on 1st July, right? And your exam is in December, so any amendment taken place in last 6 months is not applicable for December. Any amendment taken place from 1st July onwards till 31st December or till November is not applicable in your exam. But any amendment made up to 31st December is applicable for June exam. All right. And they are changing law every day. Even yesterday also some amendment took place. Right. GST law is changing every day because it's not a stable law. It's a latest law. And latest law that too totally new fundamental. Right, not old fundamentals. So latest law, fundamentals are new. Government is also struggling in implementing it. But believe me, it is going to happen. Nobody is going to withdraw GST. Even people, some people are sarcastically saying that GST is a disaster for India. It will defeat Indian growth. And many things are being said by, you know, opposition parties. And many things are going on. Even we chartered accountant finding it very difficult to implement and, you know, take a follow-up of clients and with the GST people whenever you call to GST customer care, even they are uncertain about many provision. If you go to a visit GST Seva Kendra or a GST house, right, even they are not sure about it. So people are confused about it and your exam is in confusion, right? So you hold a right to make a mistake, all right? But sir, those mistakes should be sensible one. See, if there is a confusion in an industry and if you don't know it, that's all right. But there are certain fundamental things that you must know, right? And you are expected to know that. So your exam is going to be first exam on GST. Even we are uncertain what will they ask in exam. Syllabus wise, whole GST Act is in your syllabus, right? Your syllabus, CS executive syllabus is far, far, far bigger than IPCC syllabus, but your syllabus they had covered in 84 pages, whereas IPCC syllabus is some of the chapter of CS executive syllabus, and that syllabus is more than 400 pages, right? So some chapters more than 400 pages, and all provisions 84 pages. So you can see the difference between IPCC and CS executive contained. Now sir, CS executive, that means only 84 pages, we will by heart 84 pages and we will go to exam 30 out of 30. No. Are CS, right? It is a professional exam, it's not BCom exam, right? They didn't say that whatever is written in this paper should be asked in exam. No. Whatever is in GST law can be there in exam. But what base you can take? Now you cannot do a research on GST like we people are doing. Right? You cannot read 400 pages, 500 pages for 30 marks syllabus and that too now, before exam. Okay? So we are trying to determine here some shortcut provisions. 3 days, you cannot ask me, sir, why are you teaching us in detail? Do not teach us in detail. 3 days, you cannot hold my hand. 3 days are given to me. Okay? After 3 days, we will split the batch. And then after 3 days, CS executive December batch will be only and only exam oriented batch. And by rest batch, we will wait for the latest amendment up to December and we'll start from December onwards. Am I clear? Yeah, am I clear with syllabus part? Yeah, so GST is going to be there in IPCC exam, 40 marks. GST is going to be there in CS executive exam, 30 marks. Right? CS executive MCQ pattern, as always, negative marking is there. Right? As always, I had said and again I'm saying, indirect taxes is better than direct taxes, because indirect taxes, you go home and check module of direct taxes and put this in GST on it, right? This GST will look like nothing in terms of pages, right? But there are certain fundamental things that you should understand. Now why is it difficult for me to teach you GST for old student? The very basic thing is that because you know indirect taxes, VAT and service tax. So sometime you may tend to apply those principles in GST. So my area here is that you should not apply those principles in GST if you know those principles. Right? Second, people, new batch, why is it challenging for me to teach you GST? Because sometime I'll say it was happening in service tax and you people are unaware about service tax. So you know what will be happening in our batch? I'll teach you this was happening in service tax and this is what happening. Okay? And now this will not happen. So there is a problem, this kind of problem that we are going to face, but that's all right. This is how we learn, right? This is how we are doing research. So you are students in a, you know, in a structural reform period. You are a student in country's structural reform change. Your syllabus is not changed. Country's structural reform has taken place. Constitution of India has been amended. So you are lucky enough to see all these events in your life. That this is how India has changed. You know, after 30 years, 40 years, you may share these stories with your grandchildren. There was a time, right? There was a Mr. Modi, Prime Minister of India, right? And that time he will be having some like a printed notes on like some, I don't know how famous he will be after 30 years. But he will be one of the famous personality. His name is going to be there in history of India. So you will share history with your grandchildren that this is how he has spoken. You know, he used to start his speech, Mitro. Yeah? So you will share all these stories with your grandchildren and they will be very excited to know about it. Right? If you are having grandfather as of now and if you share stories about Bhagat Singh and then Gandhiji and then Indira Gandhi and Nehru, right? So you will be, you know, quite curious about, oh, this is how it used to happen. Right? If you tell you how he used to deliver letters, right? Then letters to his girlfriend, right, which is not your grandmother, right? So, so some curious stories you will be knowing about it, right? So some stories are there to share with your grandchildren. And let's start with again history, economy, then we will go into constitution. Today's section, usual people feel that, sir, first lecture, so it will be basic one, no beta. First section is always difficult one. Second section will be easy one. So tomorrow session will be quite easier one. Today's session is completely technical, difficult, and everything is important. Every word spoken by me, every word written in our notes is important. because we don't know what they are going to ask in exam. See, earlier service tax was very big content. VAT was bigger content, right? So service tax was for 20 marks and VAT was for 10 marks. They were having plenty of sections to ask question in exam. Now those sections are gone, right? Instead of that, new sections has taken place, and we don't know which section is important and which section is not important because we don't have any trained as of now. And because none of section is important for us, every section becomes important, right? So canon of taxation, I'm starting with the economy, why this reform taken place in India, right? So from economics perspective, let's try to understand. So this is none of my taxation syllabus, but we are trying to understand economics plus. But you must have heard about all these things in your foundation, in CPT or BCom, somewhere in your life. Canon of taxation is a part of economics, right? What is canon, sir? Canons means principle. Canons means principles, right? Like Gandhiji had principle of ahimsa. You are having principle of hinsa, right? Everybody has their own fundamentals, right? Fundamental principles. So what is the principle of taxations, or what kind of fundamental rule one country should follow, is written by, given by first time economics and father of economics known as Adam Smith. He has given us this four canons, then rest of the canons were given by other economists. Okay, if some other economist has also challenged Adam Smith that this cannot be fundamentals of taxation. But believe me or not, our Indian taxation are based on this kind of, Indian or major countries taxations are based on this fundamental. So you go to any country, you read any taxation, okay, these fundamental things will be there in your exam. Alright, so what is the first canon, sir? Canon of equity, canon of equity, and it was written in Wealth of Nation book, right? So canon of equity. Canon of equity means everybody should pay same taxes. Is it a canon of equity?
No.
They say taxes should be in progressive form. Taxes should be in?
Progressive.
I know that you, these words you already know it, right? Taxes should be in progressive form. Means the rate of tax should increase with an increase in income. So it should increase in the same proportion of your income. That means people with a higher class should pay higher taxes. People with middle class should pay middle level of taxes. People with lower level of class should pay lower taxes or should not pay taxes to some extent. So every country should have progressing system of taxation, that is canon of equity. Second, canon of certainty. Certainty. Suddenly government announces today that from tomorrow 60% is your income tax rate. Is it fair? No. Certainty means, sir, we should be certain, assessee should be certain, taxpayer should be certain that how much tax am I going to pay in my assessment year. What is my assessment year in income tax, beta? 18-19. I know, we all know what taxes we are going to pay. Because whatever taxes they are going to charge in 18-19, they had already announced in a budget 17. Finance Act 2017. That means we people are certain about it. That this is what tax rate is, up to 2 lakh, 2.5 lakh, nil. 2.5 lakh to 5 lakh, 5%. 5 lakh to 10 lakh, 20%, and above 10 lakh, 30%. This tax rate is there in our mind. That means we people know how much tax is there on my income. That is canon of certainty. Okay. Canon of convenience. Is it very, very, very difficult to pay taxes in India? People are standing in a queue, right? So tomorrow, if your tax due date, from tonight you will go there, sleep there in outside income tax department. No, people used to do it. Before 10-15 years, there used to be huge queue outside income tax department, like you are having queues in temples. We had paid taxes like that, we had filed returns like that. But now, everything is digital. Everything is digital, e-governance. Everything is on electronic mode. You want to pay taxes, just open mobile app. Pay it, and online banking by credit card, debit card, everything is accepted now, right? Even if you want to go and pay in, on counter, it is convenient. You can go to any bank and pay taxes. Am I clear? Filing of return, everything is mandatorily filed by online. Nothing is offline now. Maximum things are being converted into e-governance. Even assessment. Assessment means where assessing officer questions, assessment done by assessee. That questioning also now is being conducted online, but that is optional now. As of now it is optional, but after some days it will become mandatory. That means there won't be any interaction between department and assessee unless and until on digital platform. Everything will be done on digital platform. All right. Can I go ahead? Yeah. Next one, canon of economy. Canon of economy. Have you seen income tax department office or GST office on every railway station? The moment you come out of Jogeshwari station, GST office, income tax office. The other GST office, income tax office. Right? Have you seen income tax office or excise office or service tax office or any tax office, even in past, in your village, in your district? Very rare. Right? If your district is one of the well-known and, you know, kind of developed district, then only you must have seen any tax department. That means people are earning money there. We have traders there, we are having service provider there, but we don't have tax department there. Why, sir? Because of canon of economy. Right? We are having 129 crore population. We cannot appoint one officer for each 10 people. Because that will be huge burden on revenue department of government of India. Because more the officers, more the payments, right? More the cost of collection. So there is a formula. Adam Smith said, if you are having cost of collection shall be lower than tax collection. Cost of collection has to be lower than tax collection. And that to be substantially low. It's not just that you collected tax 100 rupees and cost of collection is 99 rupees. So to collect 100 rupees you are spending, that doesn't make any sense, sir. You spend 10 rupees to collect 100 rupees, then it makes sense. Sir, why are you spending on collection, sir? Do not spend on collection, make it zero. Will you buy a ticket if there is no TC in train? We live in India, come on. We don't buy ticket even if we see TC. And we go with very confident. Right? Even we feel that we have passed for whole year. Am I clear? Yeah. And what is second thought in your mind? Even if you ask, what will he do? Fine, right? What is the probability that in a month, how many times you will get caught by TC? Once or twice. Once or twice. 100 rupees each visit, right? So monthly payment, 200 rupees. Whereas monthly pass, 1000 rupees, say for example. Right? Still you will calculate cost benefit analysis. Indian people do like this. And that's why we should have department. That is the requirement of department, that is the requirement of officers. We should have officer. But sir, officer should not stand outside my office. Oh, these many admission today, pay tax today. No, they cannot levy tax, you know, they cannot have officer like this standing outside each building, standing outside each station. No, that will be too much for government of India, and that's why they say that overall cost of collection of taxes shall be lower than tax collected amount. Okay. Canon of flexibility. Canon of flexibility means your tax law should change according to change in environment, according to change in society. So income tax was launched in 1961, right? But are we following same income tax today? No, income tax law has been changed substantially over the period of time. Substantially. Every year 20% amendments. Why this kind of amendment? Because one of the canon is that canon of flexibility. Law cannot be so rigid. Right? So GST return has to be filed every month. But server is hanged. Server is not working properly. Every day they are passing some notification for giving relief. That is canon of flexibility. Now GST is super flexible. Why? Because even they are not sure about what kind of challenges they may face tomorrow. So today they have list of 10 challenges. So GST people who are working in GST department, council, right? They sleep with 10 problems, 10 challenges today. Right? Out of 10, they achieved 4. So when they go to bed, closing stock of unattended challenges is 6. They feel that tomorrow we will wake up and tomorrow we will solve balance 6. Tomorrow what happens? 6 plus next 10. It is becoming 16. This is every day they are facing challenge and every day they are making changes. All right. Every day, do not take it literally that every day law is changing. But on weekly basis or even if you take on monthly basis, law cannot change on that like that frequently. Law should change once in a year, twice in a year, that we understand. Here law is changing every month. Okay. Yeah. Next, canon of elasticity. What is elasticity? Elasticity means if there is a economic slowdown, right? That means people should have more money. People are not having money to spend. Why there is an economic slowdown? If I make tomorrow tax rate 90%, what will happen? You will earn 100 rupees and pay tax of 90 rupees. That means money left with you for your own disposal is only 10 rupees. And in 10 rupees, you cannot survive. Then you will cut down your all expenditures. You will not go to mall. You will not buy new clothes, new electronics. And because of that, what will happen? These industries will face slowdown. And overall, there will be slowdown in the country. Right? So if there is an economic slowdown, government should reduce the taxes. So that people will have more money to spend, more money at their disposal. And if there is a high inflation in the country, that means people are unnecessary buying things, unnecessary putting extra demand because they have money, then what government will do? Increase the tax rate so that people will not have money with them. Demand can be controlled to the some extent. So elasticity, change, increase or decrease tax according to change in environment. One more, if you can write, canon of productivity. Canon of productivity, right? Now what is canon of productivity? You are a productive child of your parents or unproductive child? You people are non-performing asset, nalayaks. But tomorrow, day after tomorrow, you will become performing productive. As of now, are you performing one? No. Likewise, government cannot have unproductive acts. Unproductive acts or unproductive law means the law which doesn't make any sense. Tax which doesn't contribute anything to government of India, which is substantial. And that's why they abolish wealth tax act. Because it was there, but it wasn't followed by people seriously. So they abolish whole act in 2014. Wealth tax has been abolished. Am I clear? So canon of productivity means government should generate enough revenue. Government should generate enough revenue. Sir, why the hell government should generate enough revenue? What government will do? What government will do? If they generate even enough revenue means how much first of all? And what will they do by levying taxes? Taxes is the revenue for government of India. Right? What will they do by charging taxes? And why they are charging taxes, sir? This line is written there. Taxes are levied and collected to fund cost of civilization. And we have discussed what is civilization. You are living in civilized society where there is a defense to protect you from external attacks. There is a law and order within the country. Home ministry. Right? To protect you from internal disturbance. Right? We are having judicial system. District court, high court, supreme courts. Right? We are having police department. We are having public schools. We are having public hospitals. We are having roads, gardens. We are having municipal corporations, municipal organizations which are working for the society. Everything is managed by government. We are having public transport. And to manage all these things, don't you think that government needs money? Obviously. Who will pay money? People who are using these facilities. People who wants more and more benefit. So do you want development in India? Then how can you have development without paying taxes? So if today the service tax rate was 15%, in GST what happened? 15% became 18%. How can you say that, sir, unnecessary you are charging extra taxes? Beta, you want extra development. Earlier metro was not there in Mumbai. Now you can see construction of metro is going on. Earlier we had only one airport. Now in Mumbai we are having two airports. Right? And go to T2 and see the airport, how the construction has taken place. Awesome, beautiful airport. Right? You want more and more water conservation and more dam and, you know, rivers, right? River management, then you have to spend money on this. If you want to spend money on this, then you should generate more and more revenue. Earlier, we had a defense budget to only tackle attack from Pakistan. And we are superior than Pakistan. Everybody knows that. Okay? But now India is facing threat from China. And China is far superior than us. Right? And that means we have to do defense modernization. We have to upgrade our... I'm not saying that there will be world war or there will be war between India and China. But we have to prepare for that. Am I clear? And that's why we have to buy new and new missiles and new aircraft, new vessels, right? New defense equipments. We cannot buy defense equipment without spending money. And that's why government needs more money. That's why what is the canon of productivity? Government should generate enough money. And what is enough money, sir? To fund its all budgeted expenditures. To fund all its budgeted expenditures for development models. Am I clear? Yeah. So this is the logic why government charge taxes. Are we clear about it? And how taxes should look like? All right. GST is missing this principle, canon of? Because GST is indirect tax. And you know difference between direct tax and indirect tax. What is the difference between direct tax and indirect tax? Direct taxes are progressive in nature, whereas indirect taxes are regressive in nature. What does that mean, sir? Because direct tax are highly paid by rich people. That's okay. And poor people do not pay direct taxes. Middle average class earning people, they pay average rate of tax. Alright? Sir, but in GST, if you go to a restaurant, you will pay 18%. If I go to a restaurant, I'll pay 18%. If you are buying mobile, you will pay GST at same rate, I'll pay GST at same rate. If you buy car, you will pay same GST, I'll pay same GST. Your in level of income might be difference, my level of income might be difference, and even Ambani brothers' level of income is different, but everybody is paying same rate of tax. But what about consumption? If you buy car, you will buy Nano. Today, if you buy car, you will buy Nano. If I buy car, I'll buy, you know, car, Maruti Suzuki or some standard car, normal car. And Ambani brothers, if they want to buy car, then BMW, Mercedes, that is the start. That is the start point. That if those cars are normal car for them. Right? Then there are many international brands, right? Lamborghini is there and many brands are there that you already know. Right? And they don't buy car, they buy aircraft. There are certain this kind of people in India. They don't buy car. They buy vessels, they buy yacht, yeah, they buy aircraft, private jet. So even we have that kind of people in India. We are fighting for buying our bike or cycle sometimes. Yeah. Look at the income disparity, right? So GST is paid by everybody in India and at the same rate. So you can argue with me that, sir, canon of equity is not followed in GST, because GST is a regressive taxation. It doesn't look your level of income, but you should look your level of income, right? If you don't have income, if you are having lower income, don't go to shopping mall. Go to local shop. Local shop people are not charging GST, right? Do not buy branded clothes. Buy clothes from outside street. They are not charging GST. Do not go to bar and restaurant. Go to wine shop. At least service charges will be saved. Tax is on liquor, but at least service charges, right? Sir, if you are poor or not having enough income, do not go to AC restaurant. Go to non-AC restaurant. Right? So according to your level of income, you will spend. If you spend, you have to pay GST, because GST is a consumption-based tax. Excise was a production-based tax. VAT was a sales-based tax. Service was service-based tax. GST is a consumption-based tax. Person who wish to consume the commodities and services, he has to take burden of taxes. No exceptions. If you wish to consume commodity, you want Vodafone connection, pay bill plus 18% GST. If you want to stay in 5-star hotel, stay in 5-star hotel, pay GST. You go to Himalaya, right? Become a sadhu, beg and eat. Nobody is going to charge GST. Why? You are not consuming, you are not spending. So we are charging GST from whom? Are you paying GST on daily basis? No, because you are not paying on daily basis. But if you start earning and if you start spending, what will happen? Every money that you earn, if you spend, every time you spend, there will be a tax implication, and that tax will be GST. Alright? And I said consumption based. I said again and again consumption based. That means who should pay tax? Consumer or trader or manufacturer or service provider? Who should pay tax?
Consumer.
But consumers are India. Consumers in India, they are very polite, decent, sophisticated, well educated. Everybody will go and pay tax. So you will buy Parle G biscuit here, right? And go and pay GST in department. Because I am consuming Parle G. Chiju purchased marker this morning, right? He went there and paid the GST. Is it? That means you are supposed to pay GST. Consumers are supposed to pay GST. But obligation of collection and payment is on service provider or trader. So it is my obligation to collect and pay. But I am not supposed to pay. But if I fail to collect, my obligation. No? If I fail to collect, can I give this argument? I could not collect GST. No sir, you have to pay. As a trader, as a service provider, I have to pay GST. But they have given me right to collect it from consumer. And you know those famous word that we have. Every consumer is a customer, but every customer is not consumer. Right? So as a trader, as a manufacturer, there will be some people who will visit my factory to buy goods and consume those goods. So they will pay GST. There will be some people who will visit my factory to buy goods, not to consume, but to trade in that particular goods. Even that guy will pay GST. But the moment you say you are a trader and if you paid GST, I'll give you credit, coupons. That coupons you can settle when you will get liability to pay GST. Ultimately, person who is a trader will not take burden of GST. He'll pay GST in one hand, right? He'll get coupon for that. Then secondly, he has to pay GST on his sale. That GST will collect from trader, his customers or his consumers, right? So he is having money now with his hand. He will not pay this money to government of India. While paying this money, he will take set off of earlier coupons. I know this concept is difficult for new student, but existing students, you understand concept of set off. Right? That means traders are not paying GST, manufacturers are not paying GST, service providers are technically not paying GST. Huh? They are responsible to make payment. But technically, who is paying GST? Person who is consuming services and goods. And that's why we say that GST is a consumption based tax. GST is a? See, this thumb rule I am trying to create today, I am not going to start any section. Today we are not going to start any section. Today I am just creating fundamentals, foundation, but that foundation do not take lightly. All these words are very important. On these words, they had created the law. So sometimes we say, we read provision and we try to set our logic. What will be logic behind this section? Now you tell me, in this world, section would have come first or logic would have come first?
Logic.
So this is the logic. Today I am trying to establish logic. Senses to my GST sections. Sections we will discuss tomorrow or day after tomorrow. Right? So initially I'm just trying to set a framework and your mindset should be ready to listen what I'm saying. Right? So first statement that you should understand in GST is the GST is a consumption based tax. GST is?
Consumption based
tax. Obviously sir, GST is a consumption based tax. Second, it is not source based tax, it is a destination based tax. So one word you understood, consumption based. Second word, GST is not a source based tax, GST is destination based tax. That means income tax is source based tax. See, come on, I had discussed so many things on source based, right? If land is a source, then crop is an income. If a tree is a source, then fruit is income. And tax, what is tax? So if sources are located in India, then you have to pay income tax in India irrespective of your residential status. Whether you are ordinary resident or non-ordinary resident or non-resident, if your sources are located in India, you have to pay taxes in India. That we are discussing income tax. Now GST, look at GST. If a destination of goods or services are in India, then you should pay taxes in India. If destination is outside India, you should not pay GST. Okay, Mumbai person selling goods to Gujarat. So, two states are involved, Maharashtra and Gujarat. And both states are having their own GST. you tell me which state should collect taxes. Because what Maharashtra government will say, source is located in our state, so we will charge GST. What Gujarat will say, destination is located in our state, we will charge GST. Then Maharashtra will say, seller is located in our state. Gujarat will say, buyer is located in our state. We will say, recipient of money is located in our state. They will say, payer of money is located in our state. That means there will be dispute. There can be dispute between these two states. But will there be any dispute in my GST law? No, because I said one simple statement. Destination-based tax. GST is destination. So which state has the right to tax that particular item? Obviously Gujarat. State which purchase goods for consumption. State which has consumer. From Gujarat that goods, same goods were supplied to Bihar. Again, Bihar state is the rightful state to tax GST on that consumption, not Gujarat, because we don't have any consumer in Gujarat. So you tell me which state can earn money in GST. Come on, use your brain. I'm not going to ask you any nonsense question. So state which has more and more factory is going to make good money under GST, or state which has more and more consumer? That means having more and more factory will help you in income tax, but not in indirect tax, because now indirect tax are not source based, are not manufacturing based, are not sales based. Earlier what was happening in VAT? If seller is located in Maharashtra, VAT was sales tax, then Maharashtra government will charge tax. But now what is happening? Destination based, so consumer based tax. Consumption based tax, so it is, if consumer is located in Gujarat, then Gujarat will levy taxes. Alright, see, we are going to challenge your existing understanding, and that's why I said that it is difficult to teach existing people new law and new people old law. Alright, but let's try to, at least as of now we are clear. If you are not getting any even single statement, you should raise your hand, I'll repeat that, I'll try to frame it in a different manner. Alright, are we clear about up to now? Everybody? Nobody is sleeping? Yeah, okay. Now next, destination is, first statement was destination was, GST is consumption based tax. Second was GST is destination based tax. So if I sell goods from India to Europe, can I charge GST? No, why? Because destination of goods is outside India. But if Japan try to sell cars in India, right, then will GST apply? Yes, along with one more law, that is custom. We are having that custom law also, right? Whenever goods crosses our Indian custom frontier, Indian border, we are having the right to charge custom duty. Now they say that all indirect taxes has been merged in GST, but that is not a fact. All indirect taxes cannot be merged in GST. Custom is a unique law, it's an international kind of law. We cannot make and merge in GST, custom is still there. But two taxes from customs are merged in GST. CVD, we call it CVD, right? It's countervailing duty, CVD 3.1, CVD 3.5. There are sections, but counter, out of 8 to 10 types of custom duties, only two duties has been merged in GST. All other custom duties are still there, custom act is there, everything which was happening in customs will happen in custom even under GST era. Alright, clear? That custom law is there. Sir, what about income tax law, whether it is merged in GST? Now like income tax is a direct tax and GST is? No, some people have this doubt also, sir, all taxes are gone. One nation, one tax, one market. We heard that. Income tax was there, income tax is there, income tax will be there. If they abolish income tax and merge with GST, seriously, I'll go to Himalaya. And you can come along with me. Because we don't have any career, yaar. At least I don't have any career then. If every law is deleted and then they make a very simplified law, then my job is gone, your job is gone. So, Pradhan Mantri, right, Prime Minister of India, he said, it's not GST, it is GST. It's not goods and service tax, it's good and simple tax. The reality is that it is not simple. He just said, because he had not read it. He is a prime minister. He is having people who can read it. And they feel it easy. But ask us. I'll ask you after session. Now I cannot ask you because you know nothing about it. After completing few sections, I'll ask you, beta, is it GST or GST? So you will say, sir, it is GST with the heavy words. If they make law very simple, chartered accountants will lose their career. Cost accountant will lose their job. Company secretary is intact. Because you people don't work in GST matters, but at least legal is one of the law, is one of the compliance in India, right? Apart from that, lawyers will lose their life. What will they challenge if the law is very simple, right? So they introduce GST with the intention that there won't be any litigation under GST. Believe me or not, they'll get more business from GST. There are going to huge litigations under GST. Because unnecessary, these people are charging penalty for every small default. GST people are charging penalty for every small default. And sometimes it's not default of SSC, sometimes it's a default of department. And still I have to pay penalty. Now don't you think I'll challenge? And challenge means where? On railway station? Challenge means where? And the moment you go to court, it will start litigation process. So they subsume, they reduce the burden, they try to reduce the burden of government of India, but it won't be reduced immediately. How in longer term? If you see after 5 years, after 10 years, yes, that time GST will be one of the settled law. People would understand it. Mentally people will be ready to pay it because we human being, we resist to everything. Whether change is a better change or change is a worse change, we will resist that particular change. We hate change. How do you feel when you completed your syllabus under old scheme, service tax and VAT, and suddenly ICSI passed notification? See, technically ICSI should ask question only on the syllabus which was there till 30th June. What happens on the night of 30th June? Exactly at dot 12, President, Prime Minister, right, and our Finance Minister, they launch one button. GST, your ICSI, out of, I don't know what kind of excitement, they said GST is introduced. See, CA Institute has not introduced GST in our syllabus in November 17. Now people who are writing exam in November 17, they are crying. Sir, we are studying provisions of excise, customs, VAT, service tax, which is not there in economy. So they are feeling bad. But you people are feeling bad again. Sir, service tax and VAT easy tha sir. Kam se kam padh ke khatam ho gaya tha. And samjha bhi nahi tha sir, but we had, you know, kept in mind if this question is there, B is answer. If this question is there, then D is answer. By heart sir. Sir, 3 attempt back to back sir. I can tell even page number that this MCQ is written on page number 82. Right? But sir, now it is gone. Now you people are worried because they change your syllabus. ICA students are worried because they didn't change their syllabus. That means worry is there in everywhere. Right? We are worried because they are changing system. Right? If syllabus is changed for you, syllabus changed for me. And I hope you know my story with the service tax, right? When I was very small, young, right? I started reading service tax in 2008-2007. That time service tax was very easy. Every year they were changing service tax, we were studying it, right? 2010-11, they made amendments substantially in service tax. Earlier service tax was on cash basis, receipt basis. That means you have to pay service tax only if you received the money. In 2011, they made service tax on accrual basis, accrual or receipt, whichever is earlier. So they changed service tax fundamental. In 2012, whatever service tax was there, they deleted it. And same date, 30th June 2012, they deleted everything that I know. Yeah? More than 100 definitions, by heart it. They deleted it on 30th June 2012. And on 1st July 2012, they launched service tax with a negative list. What is the service tax with a negative list? You people know it. Comprehensive law or selective law? Service tax till 2012 was a selective law. Selective law means selective approach. That means only selected services were taxable. What changes they made in a comprehensive law? Everything is taxable other than negative list. Everything is now taxable. You have not forgotten that. If this is the environment of service, earlier only 119 services were taxable out of whole environment. In 2012, they say that this 119 plus 1, that means total 120 services are taxable as of now. And what was this one? Any other service. What happened because of this? Selected service plus any other service. That means service tax technically on all services. Then they say that any other, you know, kind of very comprehensive in nature, we should give certain benefit to industry, and then they created small list called negative list. That means, sir, if these are the services that you are providing, then we don't have levy on that because that services is covered under negative list. That means you need negative list in which kind of law? You tell me. Positive law, comprehensive law, approach, first of all, selective approach or comprehensive approach? You people need negative list in which approach? Selective approach or comprehensive approach? Comprehensive. Why? Because, sir, in selective approach, I'm not asking everybody to pay tax. I'm asking selected people to pay tax. That means we should have only list of people who are liable to pay tax. We should not have list people who are not liable to pay tax. If this is a batch of 100 students, and if I ask only first three rows should pay tax, that means other rows should not pay taxes. Do you think that it should be written in law? No. But I say everybody in this class should pay taxes except last bench. They are my favorite. Understood? So this except language is required when we say everyone, all services, all goods. Okay? GST is a combination of both. Selective as well as GST is actually selective law. It has selected list, but it also has negative list. New, something new. So earlier law was either selective or GST is both. GST, no, it is new, right? Secondly, here it was a positive list. Positive list. When law already has positive list, you need not to have negative list. Alright? GST is also positive list tax. We have list of services and list of goods taxable along with their rate of tax. And GST also has negative list. Now, why government has negative list, sir? To provide you more clarification. That's no matter what happens, this 6-7 items should not become taxable. Just for clarification. Otherwise, out of excitement, you may levy taxes on even those 6-7 items which are not subject to tax, which were not subject to tax even in service tax regime. And if you read, if existing people read negative list, you will understand it. Because you know negative list in service tax. You know how it operates. And it may have exception also. So you know that what happens with exception in negative list. What happens with exception in negative list? That becomes taxable. Exception to negative list will become taxable. Negative list is an exception to the levy. Right? And exception to exception will become levy. We have discussed that. Right? Only for old. New one, do not follow what these people are understanding. Right? That is, you know, secret language that we have. So, this is how we should understand two words. So, you understood two words? First word, GST is a consumption-based tax. Second word, GST is a destination-based. Acha, positive levy or negative levy? Both. We have positive list as well as negative list. Right? Comprehensive or selective? Both. We are having comprehensive law actually, but with a selected list. Law is a comprehensive, written in comprehensive sense, but law has selective list. So both. It's a mixture, it's a combination. Alright? So person who is exporting from India will not pay tax, but person who is importing in India will pay tax. All right, exporting state or importing state, which state will pay tax? Exporting or importing?
Importing.
Importing. Because when we talk about state level, Maharashtra level, then Gujarat is the exporting state. Gujarat is the importing state for us. All right. So importing tax will pay tax. Secondly, in old law, we had event of taxation. We had event of taxations. So in excise, what was the event? Manufacturing. In excise, what was the event? If you do manufacturing in India, you have to pay tax. In service tax, what was the event? Provide services. Then services are taxable. In sales tax, what was taxable? Sales tax. Right? So sale was the event. In income tax, what is taxable? Income. Without income, there cannot be tax. Now I'll tell you old as well as new. Okay? In old indirect tax, we had these four major laws. Okay? Let's discuss about four major laws. Excise duty, custom duty, service tax and VAT. What is VAT? Sales tax. Right? So in old law, we had these particular things. What things, sir? Excise duty, custom duty, service tax and VAT. VAT means sales tax. VAT means sales tax. Service means service tax. If you provide service, pay service tax. If you sell goods, pay VAT. All right? If you manufacture goods in India, excise duty. If you import goods in India, custom duty. You understand this? Yeah? We used to call these two taxes as event-based taxes. We used to call these two taxes as event-based taxes. That means these taxes will be paid by even if there is a single person in the transaction. So single person in transaction means I need not to sell these goods to pay excise duty. What should I do to pay excise duty? Manufacture the goods. So I manufactured and kept in my showroom. Sir, should I pay excise duty on it? Yes. Sir, I did not sell it. Beta, this is not sales tax. This is manufacturing tax. If you exercise the activity of manufacturing, you have to pay tax. That means it was based on the event. And what was that event? Event of manufacturing. Event of emerging new goods. We have discussed this to some extent, right? What was the event in custom duty? Importing the goods. So I am importing goods in India. Am I selling it? No, I am just importing goods in India. The moment I reach on Indian custom station, I have to pay custom duty. So what was the event in custom duty? Importation. What was the event in excise duty? Manufacturing. All right. But these two tax, now I don't know whether you understand this or not, but these words you should understand. These two tax are transaction based tax. What is transaction based? Now old people, they know it. New people, they should know it. Transaction you cannot do with you. There has to be somebody else. Right? Few examples that I had taken that time, I'm repeating it, okay. This hand is having pain. Alright, you are getting that story? This hand is having pain. What will I do? This hand will ask for help from this hand. Can you provide me massage? This hand said, I had attended GST lecture, income tax lecture. I know how commerce operates. You pay me consideration, then only I'll do massage. Now, I was in pain, so what I did, I took the 100 rupees, I keep it on this hand is happy now, he kept it money here, and now this hand is providing service. Can I charge service tax? Service is there? Consideration is there? Can I charge service tax? No. Nalayak, no. Why? New people are confused. Old people? There is a service, there is a consideration. Should I pay service tax? No. Why? Because sir, in service tax charging section, it was clearly written. Services provided or agreed to be provided by one person to another person. Another was there, right? That means I should provide service to another person, then only service tax was levied. Services provided or agreed to be provided by one person to another person for a consideration. So services were provided, consideration was there, but there is no other person. Sir, these goods, this hand is asking for marker. This head is having marker. You want marker? He's saying, yes, I want marker. This hand says, I purchase it for 20 rupees. If you want, I'll sell it only for 25 rupees. Now this hand needs it. So this hand paid 25 rupees, took marker. This hand is happy, this hand is also happy. Sale of goods. Should I pay VAT?
No.
Why? Obviously, sale cannot happen with the buyer and seller being the same person. Sir, your examples are no nonsense examples. It doesn't make any sense. Sir, nobody does this. Okay, beta. This is a branch. This is another branch. This is DMart Mumbai. This is DMart Pune. DMart Pune is a short in supply of goods. DMart Pune is asking DMart Mumbai, can you supply some goods to me? DMart Mumbai says, I can supply only if you pay me, because anyhow I purchase it for my sale. Now I'm not selling, I'm transferring it to you. That means there will be a loss to me. So first you pay consideration, then I'll supply the money. Although they are the same organization, but different branches, they have maintained their accounting. Alright. But there won't be any tax incidence over it. Why? Because there is no sale. Although there is a transfer of goods, although consideration was charged, but it was provided by one branch to another. Are how can you forget, yaar? There was a Krishna and Radha in this example. You know, in mythologies, you understand mythologies? Katha, right? You understand Krishna? You understand Radha? What was the relationship between Krishna and Radha? Husband, wife? No. See this love affair. God, we are doing it. We are just following it. See, doing love and affair is not an offensive thing. But having a committed girlfriend and then marrying with somebody else is an offense. Right? Now Krishna was there, Radha was there, committed to each other, deep in love. We people put murti of Krishna and Radha in our home. What about Rukmini? A legal dedicated wife of Krishna. What will she feel? You are praising Krishna and Radha. You've forgotten Rukmini. There wasn't Rukmini, right? You should know it. So Krishna didn't marry to Radha. Instead of that, he married to Rukmini. If you are a Radha, how will you feel? It's okay, it happens. Now you are not like Radha. But if you are a dedicated Radha, not current one, old scenario, then how will you feel? Disheartened, broken heart. Agar mile khuda to. Sad songs, background music, no food, right? At least few initial days you will be under depression. And Krishna is on honeymoon and he is married, and then he is enjoying his life because he is a very busy person, yeah, the God. But Krishna didn't forget Radha. That's the point here. After all these things and after tour and everything, he came. He came to see Radha. I said, see Radha. Do not go beyond your imagination. Control. They used to see each other, even after marriage. But just see and talk. Now this is the first meeting after marriage. Do you think that they'll just go to CCD, have coffee, being cool, yo man? No, yaar. This is going to be an war. Right? War between Krishna and Radha. Now what equipment Krishna was having? Basuri. right? So he came playing Basuri, very cool guy, like a Dilip sir. And Radha too, somehow like Anjish sir. Possessive, aggressive, right? Always angry, destructive in nature. So, destructive Radha and cool and calm Krishna. Now Radha started talking like, you know, anything. Like this end is going to, this world is going to end now. Like that. How did you do this? Now you know that all dialogue that you can have. You people do it, right, on regular basis. Right? Don't you have brain? Don't you have heart? What happens to my promise? Right? So everything you will, you know, just, and Krishna just playing Basuri there. Very cool. He used to stop, see Radha, and then, and with a smiling face. Now, if you smile at a person who is a destructive in nature now, extremely angry, about to, you know, blast, you're smiling. In today's scenario, there can be a case of murder on this. Yeah? And that's why you should not do this, right? Krishna and Radha was a different people, right, altogether. So after 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour, listening all abusing words from Radha, Krishna being very cool guy, lastly has happened, what happened, Radha? Now she is saying that, you mad, don't you understand, you are married now. Why didn't you marry to me, why to somebody else? Very cool guy, very cool sound, Krishna. He said that, Radha, you tell me how many people required necessary to have marriage. Marriage can be happened in, if there are two different persons. And you tell me among us, between us, who is another one? We both are one and the same. हम दोनों एक है. शादी करने के लिए दो लोगों की रिक्वायरमेंट होती है और हम दोनों में तीसरा कौन, दूसरा कौन, सॉरी तीसरा कौन, हम दोनों में दूसरा कौन है. हाँ, so you're getting the point of Krishna. Radha was confused. हाँ यार, हम दोनों तो एक है. Now I don't know exact motion and physical situations of them, but they were together, and we consider them as one, and we praise them because of this statement that they did not consider ever at their life that they are separate entity. They are one and the same entity. Because to have a transaction, you need two different entity, and they cannot do transaction with themselves. Now, thank God, Radha did not say that because we both are same, I should find somebody else. Today, if you go and tell this story to your girlfriend, she'll say, okay, Krishna, we both are same. But still you got Rukmini, so better I should have somebody with me. Right? So it will be buy to get to offer. You know? So today, do not apply this formula. It was valid only in the time of Krishna because Radha was so dedicated one. Okay, so the end of the story is that for marriage we require two different persons. Different mean actual different, not like this. Different mean person one and person two. These are not different persons. Alright, understood? But if this person is there in India and if this person is outside India, what was the situation in service tax? Now these two are branches, my branches, one body. Two branches, one branch in India, another branch outside India. Come on, Nalak, tell me, they are same or different? See, they were same in India. So what happens if one branch goes outside, abroad? So abroad branch and Indian branch. Same person or different person? Deemed to be different person, Nalaks. Different but not actual. Actually, they are not different. Actually, they are one and the same. But it was deemed to be in GST they had taken same principle but on state level. So branch in Mumbai, branch in Pune, same person, no GST. Branch in Mumbai, branch in Surat, so branch no, deemed to be different person. Sir, but I supplied my goods to branch only, sir. Still taxable. Because transaction is not taxable here. Event is taxable. And what is that event? Supply. We have whole dedicated lecture on this word, supply. Like we had dedicated lecture on service, we are having whole dedicated lecture on supply. So you tell me, GST is a transaction-based tax or event-based tax? Event-based tax. So what kind of summary that you should create in your mind as of now? GST is a destination-based tax, GST is a consumption-based tax, and GST is a event-based tax. That means even if there are no two different persons, there will be implication of tax. Usually what was the situation in service tax? Service provider, service receiver. Situation in VAT? Seller, buyer, right? Service tax, GST, supplier. Do we need recipient? Is it mandated to have different recipient? No, only supplier is needed. Why? Because supply is taxable under GST. All right. Are we clear about basic thing about GST? Yeah. So I want to enter into my technical sessions now. These are the like ground that I created. Right? So you should not ask me any nonsense doubt later on. Sir, branch 1 is transferring goods to branch 2 and there is no consideration, sir. How can you ask them to pay GST? They have to pay GST. Because sale is not taxable. Event is taxable. It is not sales tax. It is not manufacturing tax. It is not service tax, it is new, goods and service tax, and this is tax on supply. Like income tax is on income, this is tax on, income tax is on person, this is on goods and services. So can you differentiate income tax and GST? Now forget about other indirect taxes, but distinguish income tax and GST. Income tax progressive in nature, GST regressive in nature. Right? GST, income tax is on source base. GST is on destination base. Right? Income cannot be earned by a same person from himself. GST can be charged even if goods are supplied by same person but to different branch. All right. Income tax is a transaction based tax. You need to earn income to pay taxes. Here, event based, there has to be an event, that's all. Income tax is a national level tax. We don't have Maharashtra income tax. GST is a national level as well as state level. They say that one nation, one tax. Bullshit. One nation, one national level tax, 29 state level tax, 2 union territories tax, and 1 for 5 other union territories. Union territory. That means GST is a bunch of 32 laws, 32 act, and every act has their own rules, and then there are subordinate act also, compensation act and amendment act. That means if you want to understand whole GST, you have to read around 35 to 36 act. I'm not asking sections, act. It's not one nation one tax, and that's why some people are questioning the validity of one nation, one tax, one market. Then what is the reality, sir? Are you going to teach us 35 act? Am I looking mad, psycho? Do I look like that? Lunatic? Person who throw stones and bricks on road? No. I'm not going to teach you 35 act. I'll teach you CGST. Central level GST. On all other GST acts are origin from central level GST. 99% same. That's why they say that one nation, one tax. Understand one tax, apply to everywhere. Apply to Maharashtra, apply to Gujarat, apply to UP, apply to even Jammu and Kashmir now. You know service tax? It wasn't applicable in GST. One MCQ is done. They are going to ask this question because this is what the confusion. GST extends to whole of India. Including, you should understand that now. But service tax was not like this. Service tax has some different language. It extends to whole of India excluding, right? But you should understand now. Jammu Kashmir is under taxable or not. Jammu and Kashmir is the last state, by the way, which has approved GST. So GST was approved on night 12 o'clock of 30th June and morning of 1st July. This not like they passed GST on around 4 or 5 o'clock. They started a meeting and they passed approved around 4th July or like after central GST. They approved the law after central GST, not before central GST. Alright. But as of now, applicable or not applicable? Applicable. Obviously, Jammu and Kashmir is also under taxability. Alright. So this is how you should understand basic about thumb rule about GST. We will add few more thumb rule. I hope you are clear with those at least three thumb rules. Right? Now let us go in a hierarchy of law. Now this is going to be a technical session. Hierarchy of law means which is a supreme law of India, supreme. That means none of the rule, regulation can go beyond that particular law. That is constitutional. And we have discussed this. Do not act like you have not listened this particular thing anytime in your life, right? Now, Constitution of India is divided into articles, and to support articles, we are having some schedules, right? So, Constitution of India is having articles as well as schedules. Sir, who made Constitution of India? So, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar and committee. But that Constitution we are not following today. The Constitution that we follow today is ratified by states, central government along with approval of state government. 75 states should approve for any changes that we make in Constitution of India, right? It cannot be only changed by central, but obviously proposal will be given by central government. Am I clear? So this is a supreme law. To follow some disciplinary mechanism in India or to make a law for a particular thing, we will create an act, a law. So act is a part of Constitution. Act originates from Constitution. And that's why none of my provision of act can ever override Constitution. Am I clear? So if Constitution of India say situation A is valid and my act says situation B is valid, right? So which one will be is? So there are two things applicable in same situation, A and B. Act is saying B is right, Constitution is saying A is right. Which will win? A. Why? Because Constitution of India is a supreme law. We cannot, act cannot declare Constitution invalid, but Constitution can declare act invalid. Ultra vires, void ab initio. What does that mean? Void from beginning. Which one? Constitution or act?
Act.
Right? Act usually they divide in chapters and sections, right? So we have discussed income tax and they are divided into chapters and then chapters are divided into sections. Who makes act in India? Parliament, not Supreme Court, not High Court, not even central government, not Modi uncle. Who makes law? Parliament. Parliament means Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. And we elect people who are appointed as a member of Parliament. That means technically this GST law is passed by us for us. Who passed government, who passed the GST law? You and me. And now you are crying for it. Sir, we didn't pass. Jetli uncle did not come to our house. Jetli uncle went to Parliament House. And you have your representative in? If he says yes, then you said yes. That means next time while voting, understand that person is going to represent you. Whatever is the opinion of that person is the opinion same applicable on your society or your area. So he is a representative of whole that part. Am I clear? So if he says yes, so you people are saying yes. If he says no, then you people are not supporting it. And although India is a federal structure country where 100% people will never agree to one particular thing, because job of opposition is to oppose. GST was proposed by Congress. That time BJP was opposing it. Now BJP proposed and Congress was opposing it. The law what they had created, they were opposing it. So whether change is a beautiful or not, the job of opposition is to oppose the thing, oppose the change, resist the change, right? Am I clear? Yeah. So they had done it, but although like they win the majority and they could pass easily act in Lok Sabha, it was quite difficult to pass in Rajya Sabha. But Lok Sabha was with they have majority now, right? India government is having majority in a Lok Sabha. So these are the historical moment that you should know. Political structure. So my job is not to give you insight of politics. For that, www.anjasar.com. Are a political things I cannot discuss. Yeah. So rules to support act, we will have rules. Rules are administrative things. So you should file income tax return. Is written in Income Tax Act. But form of income tax return, right, methods, which site, so technical things, those are not written in Income Tax Act, those are written in income tax rules. So rules are there to help act. Can a rule override act?
No.
Can a rule override constitution?
No.
Then we will declare that rule as void ab initio, void from beginning. That's why you should understand this hierarchy, okay? And last, it comes bylaws. Bylaws given by your institute, my institute. Sir, what is this AS? Accounting standards. What is SA? Standards on auditing. What is GN? Some knowledge students are saying good night. Guidance notes, right? Is guidance notes. Then there are compliance standard issued by ICSI and there are cost accounting standard issued by CMA. So each institute has issued some standard for their members. ICAI cannot issue standard for local people, right? Local people, they don't read accounting standard, but we chartered accountant, we have to buy out accounting standard because the standards were meant for us. Because as a chartered accountant in Mumbai, whatever balance sheet you prepare, whatever accounting fundamental you apply, chartered accountant in Delhi should apply same fundamentals. Because we are chartered accountant under body of government of India, that is ICAI. And you cannot have different standing, and that's why we should prepare a standard financial statement. A standard means which looks exactly same. And because of that, we should follow standards. It's standards given till, you know, it's like a father teaching their child. Beta, while doing accounting, you should follow this. Beta, while valuation closing stock, NRV or cost price, whichever is lower. If this statement is valid in Mumbai, this statement is valid in Delhi and even in South India. Why? Because this is prepared by a body which is a parent body for everybody, all members. Likewise, your company secretary institute has prepared compliance standard. Likewise, CMA institute has prepared cost accounting standards. So whatever costing you are learning now, standard costing, marginal costing, absorption costing, everything is written in a document form. And those documents are called as cost accounting standard. Cost sheet that you prepare, it is given in cost accounting standard 5. Compliance is that you follow in real industry, it is written in compliance standard. Account that you have been followed from your 11th standard is written in accounting standard. Are we responsible to follow this standard, sir? As a member of institute, you are responsible. For ordinary people, it is enough if they follow only 1, 2, 3. But as a member of institute, 1, 2, 3 along with 4. But can ICAI today pass a notification that section 9 in GST Act is not right section? This is the right section that you should follow. And I'm saying that technically that original section is the wrong section. That means ICAI, whatever ICAI is saying is more sensible than government of India. What will be the valid? Statement passed by ICAI or statement prepared by government of India? Obviously, and that's why we are discussing hierarchy, that ICAI cannot do anything, ICSI cannot do anything. If you want to change law, apply. Parliament will take a call on it. As a member of institute, you are having a right to write a letter to Government of India, and your letter will be accepted and your comments will be read by even finance secretary and finance minister. So it is ICAI responsibility. You write a letter to ICAI, ICAI will follow that letter to, letter means mail. Today, in today's world, it is mail. So you write a mail to ICAI or your institute, ICSI, and same mail will be forwarded to ministry, and you won't believe it is accepted by ministry. It will be accepted if it is sensible. So you identify any lacuna in the law, any loophole in the law, you want to make changes in that particular law, your responsibility is to just write a letter and take a follow-up. Obviously, one mail shoot and then automatically it will not change. You need to follow, right? And if you have written letter, that means there are many chartered accountants in India, even they will write a representation, and those representation will be presented to parliament or people who are responsible to make certain changes. Okay, so this is hierarchy of India. Now take a 5-minute break. I need to prepare another chart on Constitution of India. Okay.